Hi, I'm Tristan Noon. I'm the composer of The Horseman. Danny Lacey approached me a few days ago and asked me if I'd like to do a kind of guest blog video to run through my setup and the different pieces of the show, really. So I thought I'd just pick out the main theme and maybe a couple of the underscorey bits so you can kind of get a breakdown of what's going on in the arrangement, because there's one thing about this arrangement where it's three chords, very simple melody, but there's so much going on in the arrangement, so it just thickens it out. I'm running Cubase 7. I was running Pro Tools before that, which is great for audio, but not so good for MIDI. A relatively fast PC, a couple of monitors, a couple of nice Yamaha HS50Ms. They don't lie, because I've used Adam A7s before, and they lie to you. They make things sound better than they are. Lots of nice plugins. I've recently bought Tony Maserati. He's a really famous mixing engineer. He's released a set of plugins for guitar, bass, drums, and it just helps make the sound nicer. So when you mic things up and DI stuff, direct input, it just sweetens things up without you having to spend hours and hours honing and fine tuning. I'm also running Valhalla Vintage Verb, really nice reverb plugin. It was only about £50. Most of the other plugins really are, Chris Lord Alge guitars and vocals, and just mainly most of the Cubase stock plugins, which do nicely, to be honest. And Ozone for mastering, which I'll get onto that later. Okay, it's a very simple kind of, very simple format. You know, it's you've got that kind of repetitive melody coming back at the end just to make it slightly more memorable. I chose purposely to start with that harmonica thing because I don't know anything else that starts with that, so I thought just to try and make it unique. Here's the guitars soloed on their own. This was recorded by Fraser Roskilly, the guy I use. He plays in a really good band, so he does all the guitar stuff that I can't, the really kind of difficult bits. I'm not good enough to play this this melody. Slightly panned left and right, that helps really thicken the sound out when you start panning things left and right. There's a delay, lots of reverb. There's a delay on one of them. So yeah, there's the second repetition, the first repetition. And you can hear the delay. This is before it was mastered. Mastering basically, in the process of mastering, you apply EQ, compression, limiting, just thickens it out, punches the whole thing up, just makes it sound generally sweeter. So like you'll hear in that main track that there's a tambourine and a snare, and I've really pushed the compressor to the limits on those in the mid range. So they really snap, the snare and the tambourine really snap. Whereas on this unmastered version, it's not as punchy. And just the other guitars, what's this doing? Yeah. So that's just kind of keeping the general rhythm going of the actual piece. Very simple. I didn't do that, Fraser did. And I also doubled MIDI guitar, so just playing it on the keyboard as well as. Luckily that's buried away, because that sounds terrible. That's cool. I always like doing that in tracks because it just thickens it out, gives it a bit of rhythm. Nothing you can really hear, but if it wasn't there, you'd probably know about it. These kind of country bluesy kind of guitar little bits. So that's mainly what's going on with the guitars. The percussion, funnily enough, when I listened back to the percussion, when I soloed the percussion, there's this instrument called the jam bucket. And when you solo this up, well, you can actually hear it in the actual theme itself, but it sounds like kind of hooves hitting on the floor. Now that really wasn't a conscious decision at all, but it works with horses. It sounds like horses' hooves kind of hitting on the floor. Then the kick drum comes in and gives it some oomph. wood scrape in there as well. Claps, gotta have claps. Claps and shaker. So it's just interesting to, I think it's interesting for some people to hear, you know, because like with pop music, I'm always interested in what's going on underneath all the layers. There's so much going on that you don't hear, but has to be there. And this organ as well is really vital. So you've got this kind of thing going on. That, all that is me holding two notes. Running my hands down the keyboard. And it just brings it into a new section rather than, if that got left out, I think you'd really notice. Just brings it into that main melody. There's a piano pulsing away down here. Simple chords. This whole track basically comprises of D sus 2, C9 and G. Three chords. That's all you need. This is quite funny. This is, you can't really hear it in the actual tracks, it's kind of buried so low, but basically I sung into the microphone like this. Very low. Just, I don't know why I did that. I think in the temporary music, there was some kind of low ooze at some point, and I thought that'd work well in the main theme. There you go. Tuned with lots of reverb, because I'm awful at singing. So that kind of gives you an idea of what's going on with this main theme. You know, being a main theme, if it's not memorable, which I hope that is in some way, it's got to have something distinctive about it. So I thought that harmonica at the start was a really good way of kind of grabbing people's attention. Just a little bit of distortion as well on there, just to make it a bit more gritty and greasy, because I think with a lot of this country bluesy kind of stuff is very gritty. It's not, you know, the sounds aren't massively clean, although acoustic guitar-y bits, you know, you need stuff that's clean. So that kind of gives you a rundown of the main theme. For tracks like these, that are going to be used for the underscore, Danny and Hattie from Stardom Media will send me what they call temp tracks, temporary music. So they normally edit to those kind of tracks, so they know how it's going to feel when the music's in there. And it just gives them an idea of how it's all going to look and sound when everything's done. So my aim is to take the elements from those temp tracks and build on them. Make it my own style, and you know, do my thing to it, because ultimately that's why they're hiring me to add my own take. The drums are very simple. I mean, on these kind of tracks, lots of percussion going on. These purple tracks of the percussion parts, and there's a lot of processing going on with these tracks, with EQ and compressing, because when you get this many tracks, and there's like 60 tracks in here, you know, doing different stuff. When you get that many tracks all going on at once, if you don't start cutting out low end and doing all that kind of stuff, it can really make stuff really muddy. So there's lots of processing. I don't want to play too many of them solo, because they probably sound terrible on their own, but once they're layered up, what's going on here? So that's stereo pan, that's me just strumming the guitar, the acoustic. That's lots of reverb, and got an amp simulator on this one, so I put it through an amplifier to make it much more gritty, as I was talking about earlier. Kick drum. This is it with the Tony Maserati plugin on. Just makes it more punchy. You can see how it's got more high end on when it's off. Just tightens up the bass. Tightens up the bass end. And you've got these Just a breakdown section, because when you've got that much going on and it gets really, you know, anticipation's built, you need something to drop it back down so that it doesn't get boring for the... I mean, these tracks already get chopped up by the sound guys, so it's not too much of a problem. In a lot of these tracks, I'm using Hans Zimmer percussion. So as you go into sections like these, this gives it that push. And also an effects spring. There's kind of a spring type noise. I mean, there's all these things that the listener probably won't notice, but especially as it's buried under dialogue and, you know, stuff going on, but it just gives it, it breaks it up a bit. And just in music, in these kind of pieces, you just need subtle things, just bring in weaving. It's just like weaving a carpet. Tambourine as well, fake tambourine. What I tend to do is layer up live sounds with fake sounds. I'm also using this beautiful SE Electronics 2200A Mark II to capture all this stuff. Yeah, they've actually thought about the design, which is, all comes as part of its own package. That was a really good buy. And in general, just trying to be, you know, always think about the end result of it going down to pitch. So I tend to mix at a low level at the end, because ultimately it's not really played this loudly. Oh. It's not going to be played this loudly when there's dialogue over the top of it. So you've got to mix it at a low level at the end, just make sure all the elements are coming through. In terms of inspiration, I'm not writing to picture per se. It's not that kind of thing where I'm hitting cuts like it might be in a film or something like that. So I'm following the temp tracks, picking out elements, and from there going on to write my own pieces. I tend to sit down and write notes, what it is that I need to do, what instruments I need to include, what kind of vibe do I need to get from this. So essentially, this is a reflective piece designed for when Shadi's talking to the camera in an interview. And I was sat there playing these chords, can't remember what they are, on the electric piano. And sometimes when you just play certain chords or have a certain effect, I had this delay on the electric piano and it just made me feel reflective. And I thought, well, this could really work well for when Shadi's just talking to the camera, so I'll kind of talk you through it. Floating at the top as well. Yeah, and it's all about the subtlety. You've really got to... That pad makes a huge difference. Although it may not seem like it. If it wasn't there, you'd notice it. Something comes in over the top. The bass. Not yet. Don't know my music. Kind of music, you can just tell straight away when you're writing it what path you need to lead yourself down. There's nothing worse than getting to the end of a piece and thinking, what am I aiming for? So I try and sit down. I've actually got some notes here. So laid back music, what chords are we using, and what kind of vibe I'm going for in general. And that's important to do that, definitely, for sure. I hope this has been useful, because it's always interesting talking about the process and how you came to certain ideas, and I've really enjoyed it. So thank you, Danny, for asking me to do this. And please check out my website and my SoundCloud. And it'd be great to work with you, whoever you are out there. Thank you very much.